first, I would like to thank Vanessa for her story, that how she is so passionate and reminding us to be more loving also in the clinic. And also, I want to apologize because some of my first slides will be repetitive, because some of the introduction was already shown about low-grade glioma. And I would like to thank you for giving me the opportunity to present my data on dual inhibition of the mTOR and MAPK pathways in pediatric low-grade glioma. Yeah, pediatric low-grade glioma is the most common brain tumor in children. It is characterized as a slow-growing tumor, and if it's growing, then it's more pressure on the surrounding healthy parts of the brain. The symptoms are very diverse. It depends on the area in the brain where the tumor is growing. It could be vision problems, seizures, premature puberty, clumsiness, and changing in behaviors. Pediatric low-grade glioma has actually a very good outcome, but has lifelong disabilities, but maybe also probably because of the treatment options. And in rare cases, there are also a malignant transformation possible. If you here see in this MRI pictures, the tumor is here shown in this white area. It's close to the eyeball, close to the optic nerve, and you actually can see the picture of the patients which is correlated to the MRI image. And this MRI image, here you can see the brain tumor closely to the cerebellum. Like already mentioned, standard treatment so far was surgical resection. Sometimes it's not possible because of the area in the brain where the tumor arises, and therefore it's also unresectable. Radiotherapy, already mentioned, has long-term toxicity and in regards of the young age of the patient has a high risk of secondary malignancy. And chemotherapy, for until now, standard treatment was carboplatin-based therapies which are available since 20 years or more. And resistance occurs very quickly. So what we need are novel, less toxic, and more efficient therapies. We and others discovered with better methods and characterization of these tumors new targets. Targets are also mentioned before as the mTOR pathway and the MAPK pathway. And how this arises is most likely because of mutations. I just want to pointing out two mutations, also here BRAF fusion, BRAF V600E mutation. For example, here in the cerebellum, you will most likely find mutations in BRAF fusion to 98%, but for example, in the hemispheric area, they have to 25%, you have a BRAF V600E mutation. What we do, and also other labs, is derive cell lines that are specific for these mutations and or for the patients to find better ways in targeting these tumors. How are we doing this? We're getting biopsy or autopsies from the patients during surgery, and then we have becoming like a tissue explant to the lab. And our research associate, Ming Yang, she's very motivated and is very passionate about this to drive new cell lines. And how she's doing this? She's getting this tissue explants, and then she derived like single cells tissue. Then she's transplanting them into murine models. This is then called in vivo. We can transplant the single cells inside the brain or inside the flanks. This is depends how it's better growing. We're doing both methods. Or we're doing straight single cells in cell culture. This is called in vitro with artificial media, growth factors, and so on. And we're hoping then the cells are growing. This is actually most common what we're doing in tumor biology, how to derive cell lines. Unfortunately, in pediatric low-grade glioma, this is most likely not possible because the cells just stop to grow. And this is actually our dilemma. We don't have enough cell lines. And my PI, Eric Rabe, discovered a couple years ago the reason behind this. And this is called so-called oncogene-induced senescence. Senescence is actually just another word for aging, or we age over time. And how this happened in this specific case is the reason is here as well, BRAF V600E mutation. And what he did, he introduced with genetically modification in a wild-type neural stem cell culture, which is actually growing independent or forever, the BRAF V600E mutation. And what you can see is over time, the cells just stop to grow. And they're also changing their morphology, the cells becoming larger. And this is already a sign for senescence. And what you can see in this picture, the cells are blue. This is a staining for beta-galactosidase activity, is called, and if the cells are senescent, then they are blue, shown here. This whole study was funded also by the Children's Cancer Foundation and was published in 2011 in Clinical Cancer Research. So, behind oncogene-induced senescence, a little bit to the background. So you have healthy cells, then you become an oncogene signal, like a BRAF fusion mutation, and then you have, like we say, pre-malignant cells. And then the cells can kind of, very simplified, decide, oh, I go into senescent pathway, or I go more likely to early cancer. Senescent cells, they are secreting other cytokines, and then they're activating more or less the immune system that can be seen, and the senescent cells get eliminated. In this pathway, in early cancer, the immune system cannot really see anymore the cells or the changes in the cells, and it becomes a transformation to more tumor progression, malignant cancer. Most likely there is what so we called a second hit to the cells, why they cannot be seen by the immune system. But this is the reason why we don't have, and this reason that the cells going into the senescence pathway is, that's why we don't have enough cells available for research. What does it mean is, it can be caused in insufficient preclinical testing. And this is like what I say, sorafenib story. Sorafenib was already available. It was an oral bioavailable, so it can be given as a pill. It's a small molecule multikinase inhibitor against a mutant BRAF. Then in the study, the preclinical study was used a cell line which was genetically modified with a BRAF V600E mutation. And to avoid oncogene-induced senescence was further genetically modified. And in this preclinical studies, with this small molecule, was really convincing data it will work. So they started a phase two clinical trial. And here is the beginning of this clinical trial. There's MRI images from this patient with this size of the tumor, and when the clinical trial started, the size of the tumor was like this. In this clinical trial, there were 12 patients enrolled, and after 3 months in the clinical trial, after giving sorafenib, the tumor grew faster, even faster without treatment. This happened to 11 from 12 patients, and immediately they stopped the clinical trial. That's why it's important to have really the right cell models to do preclinical trials. Coming back to our research associate Ming, she has a background in stem cell biology, so she knows also here, okay, how delicate cell culture can be, and she had an idea, let's use feeder cells. Feeder cells is used for embryonic stem cells or iPS cells just to feed them. It's really like what it says, to support the iPS or embryonic stem cells. What you do is, you use these feeder cells, you add media on it, and you let them sit for 48 or 72 hours. Then you collect the media, purify them from other cells or dead cells, and then we're adding still other growth factors to the conditioned media, and then finally we could grow pediatric low-grade glioma. Until now, we have a couple of new cell lines, but I want to focus on our first human-derived NF1-driven pediatric low-grade glioma cell line. This patient, I want to mention, he was 16 years old when he was diagnosed with an NF1 loss. It was an optic pathway low-grade glioma. He was treated at Johns Hopkins. He became, as first line of treatment, carboplatin. Then he became resistant to carboplatin, and later he became everolimus, what was already mentioned earlier, as a mTOR inhibitor. Later, he became also resistant to everolimus treatment, and then at this time point, we were able to get a biopsy from this patient, and Ming, she could culture this cells from this biopsy in vitro in conditioned media. And here you can see the patient, where is the tumor. This is our cell line, and this GFAP is a specific marker for low-grade glioma. We have positive cells in culture, and the blue staining is for the nuclei. Further, we could confirm that NF1 is not expressed in our cells during passaging. So don't get confused. This biochemist pathways. I just want to mention, like I mentioned before, the MAPK pathway and the mTOR pathway is highly activated in low-grade glioma, and this can be caused by the BRAF mutation or the NF1 mutation. And both pathways are very, very important in the cells. They give us life, but also they're interacting with each other, they have feedback loops. And what we want to do when they are hyperactivated, what is caused by a BRAF and NF1 mutation, we want to block them, both at the same time. And this, what we want to block then later, the proliferation or hyperproliferation of the cells. How we want to do this? Like also mentioned before, there are a couple of treatments available, also which are already FDA approved, and we choose as a MAPK inhibitor trametinib. It's a MEK1 and 2 inhibitor. It's already FDA approved for metastatic melanoma with a BRAF V600E mutation. Resistance often occurs after 7 to 8 months, and it's also orally available, and it passes through the blood-brain barrier. Side effects are including skin rash, redness, pain of skin, but they're all treatable. And what we hope when we're doing a combination therapy, that we can reduce the dosing, and also hope so the side effects will be reduced. So now to the other inhibitor what we want to use, the mTOR inhibitor. This is so-called TAK-228. This is a second-generation mTOR inhibitor, which dual inhibits both complexes, mTORC1 and mTORC2. And like here you can see everolimus is just an mTORC1 inhibitor, and with TAK-228 we hope that we can block both at the same time. Also, TAK-228 passes through the blood-brain barrier, and it has an extremely short half-life. It's not approved by the FDA yet, but we are able to start a clinical trial under the leadership from Jeff Rubens from our lab, and also preliminary data was funded by the Clinical Cancer Children Cancer Foundation, and this clinical trial will investigate the combination of TAK-228 and carboplatin in pediatric brain tumors. Now again to the pathway. Here you can see our MEK inhibitor trametinib will inhibit here this protein, and mTORC1, mTORC2 inhibitor TAK-228 will block AKT and phospho-S6. This is our goal. This is a hypothesis. Let's see if it will really work. What I have done, I want to show you all my data, which is currently under revision in neuro-oncology as manuscript. First of all, I seeded out the same cell member, and I treated them with vehicle. Vehicle is just the substrate in which the drugs are dissolved. Then I treated with TAK-228, 10 nanomolar, trametinib, 10 nanomolar, and combination also, both drugs in 10 nanomolar. And when you see here the images, you probably see here in combination I have less cells after 72 hours compared to vehicle, probably also for trametinib and also TAK-228. I did further testing with more concentrations, and what is very important is with other mathematics, I could calculate both drugs are reacting synergistic, inhibiting cell growth. For example, here in combination treatment in the NF1-driven cell line, I have already a significant inhibition in cell growth by 1 nanomolar, and this was not achieved in mono treatment. So cell proliferation was inhibited, also what we saw in clinical relevant dosing. But what is now about the inhibition of the pathways? Here again, the pathways, what do we want to look at? MAPK pathway and mTOR pathway. First, I want to highlight the mTOR pathway inhibition. Phospho-AKT is the active protein for the mTORC2 complex. Phospho-S6 and Phospho-4-BP1 are the proteins, activated proteins for mTORC1. The phosphorylation means really the proteins are activated. The total protein amount means just the protein is there, but doesn't mean anything about activation. So what I can see is if I'm adding more drug, like I'm starting here with 1 nanomolar, 5, 10, 20, the phosphorylation goes down for AKT. Also the same for phospho-S6 and phospho-4-BP1. If I look into the MAPK pathway, the inhibition in, after combination treatment is already gone for 60% at 1 nanomolar area. Then I was looking again into images from the microscope, and I saw also here a changes in morphology. And I was like, okay, the cells actually don't grow, but I also don't have so many apoptosis cells floating around in the media, so probably I will check for senescence. Also here I did the same staining for beta-galactosidase activity, and what you can see here, under trametinib treatment and combination treatment, I have positive staining for beta-galactosidase. No activation was seen in vehicle or TACTO28 treatment. So this together is my in vitro data, which I would like to summarize here. Cell proliferation was inhibited in clinically relevant dosing. The combination treatment inhibits both pathways, and trametinib and combination induces senescence in a human NF1-driven pediatric low-grade glioma cell line. With this encouraging data, we wanted to go then in vivo. Our in vivo model is also patient-derived with a cell model. It has the BRAF-V600E mutation. And our model here system is also mice, and we're using immune-competent mice, what means they don't have an immune system. That's why we can actually transplant human cells, otherwise they would get rejected from the mouse. So what we do, we're transplanting a specific cell number inside the flanks with supporting hydrogel, waiting for a couple of days until 10 days, so they are reaching a size where we actually can measure the tumor, and that then after treatment what we like to see is actually a reduction into the tumor size, like here. And also this was actually happening. Under combination treatment, I saw a significant reduction into tumor size after 12 days. I also saw a significant reduction under mono treatment, but the significance was not so strong. More strikingly was actually that I saw an increase in survival. And the blue and red line are the mono treatment, black is the vehicle in this Kaplan-Meier curve, and the green line is the combination treatment. And in combination treatment, the mice survived three times longer than mono or the vehicle treatment cohort. Then we were also looking if we're actually hitting the pathway after treatment, and what I always did before I sacrificed or isolated the tumors, I treated the mice again 4 hours before we sacrificed the mice, so I really know if we're still hitting the pathway with the tumor size. So here I show you the mTOR pathway inhibition under trametinib, TACTO28, and combination treatment. Again, TACTO28 is responsible for the mTOR inhibition, and what you see here in brown is actually the phospho-S6 activation. Under TACTO28 treatment, I have less positive cells and even less positive cells in combination treatment. Later, we also checked for the MAPK pathway inhibition for phospho-ERK staining, and this was quantified by a pathologist, Dr. Charles Eberhardt. He became blinded slides, and he did an H-score for phospho-ERK staining, and after quantification, I saw a significant reduction in phospho-ERK and combination also under trametinib treatment. Nothing was changed under TACTO28 treatment compared to vehicle. Later, we checked also for proliferation inhibition. For this, we have a marker so-called Ki-167 staining. We stained the tumor slides for this marker. And also here, after blinding our slides, we saw a significant reduction in proliferation in the tumor tissue, also significant reduction in trametinib treatment. So to get these nice slides, to stain them, I had to isolate the flanks, the flank tumors. So the BT40, this cell line is called BT40 with the BRAF V600T mutation, is a very soft, very so-called bloody tumor. So that means a lot of blood vessels in this tumor. And then I was also isolating the combination treatment, and I saw changes. The tumor was more white, more stiff. It totally changed. And this was then the conclusion, something happened to the vascularization. And this we investigated then further. So there are different markers for blood vessels. One of them is CD31, CD34, and then also VEGF. VEGF promotes the blood vessel for growth. And in this Western blot, I can show you that in combination treatment, in four different tumors for isolated from mice to the significant reduction in CD31, CD34, and also VEGF. So this is why we conclude the combination treatment of taxotrate and trametinib has an effect on blood vessel formation. They are reducing the blood vessel formation. A summary, I want to tell you that taxotrate and trametinib inhibits cell growth in pancreatic low-grade glioma cell lines in clinical relevant dosing. The combination treatment inhibits mTOR and MAPK pathway. Mono and combination treatment reduces the tumor size. The combination treatment increases survival. The combination treatment suppresses blood vessel formation in tumors in vivo. So take-home message, I would say now, our preclinical data support the combination of the mTORC1 and mTORC2 inhibitor taxotrate and the MEK inhibitor trametinib for advancement in pancreatic early phase clinical trials. My future research direction is I want to like to investigate now the pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic studies on taxotrate in combination with carboplatin in human NF1 and BRAF600E driven pancreatic low-grade glioma. Why again carboplatin? Because the children are treated with carboplatin and we have this, the NF1 driven cell line which is already carboplatin resistant and she is still resistant in cell culture. And I would like to study the combination of TAC-228 and TAC-580 in pancreatic low-grade glioma models. What is now TAC-580? It's a novel MEK inhibitor. It has a very short half-life. It targets specific BRAF600E and BRAF fusion. And it's from the same company like TAC-228, what makes it very likely maybe to get in clinical trials. I would like to thank you, the Eberhard Rabe Rodriguez Lab, for letting me do their work there, then Ming for your incredible work in the cell culture, derived the cell lines, and is the good soul from our lab, and Lauren Hess, she was a very great student for me to also finishing up this project, and of course the funding source. Thank you so much. Questions?
So for the in vivo model, do you think the combo treatment is, and the effect of the tumor shrinking is a vascular phenomenon? Because in the in vitro data, you're showing that it's actually directly killing the tumor cell itself. But if it is more of a, you know, angiogenesis issue and is not actually directly killing the tumor, or what do you think, what are your thoughts on the in vivo results?
I believe it's both. We investigated and also further in vitro the effect of vascularization with human endothelial cell lines, and we saw this effect. That this really has an effect on endothelial cells, and also it is known that the mTORC1 and mTORC2 can inhibit the angiogenesis. I believe that apoptosis can happen in the tumor cells, but in the end, the tumor is shrinking. The blood vessels are reducing, so the tumor cannot get any more oxygen, something else, and it will shrink and will don't grow anymore. I believe it's both. It's inhibition of the proliferation, and it's also the vascularization, inhibition of vascularization.
Was quite toxic, and so it wasn't initially moved forward in adults. And I may have missed this, I apologize. Very nice presentation, but did you talk at all about kind of how the dosing that you were using or the concentrations compare to what we would use clinically?
The dosing what we're using is clinical relevant, and also what we saw in vivo, and also we know that, for example, what goes inside the brain when we're using TAC-228, and what we use as dosing is clinical relevant, can go, and also the other comment about toxicity, I saw side effects in our in vivo experiments, and we had weight loss, and especially in the two mice, which survived actually the longest, had the smallest tumors, and they survived the longest and had side effect like skin rash. So in between, I actually stopped also treatment, and then I reintroduced the treatment until the weight came back to the normal age group, and then still the tumor was shrinking. That's why we survived this.
Clinically, I think some of us have interest and have sometimes moved to intermittent dosing with some of these agents. So it could be interesting to look at that. There's not really data for that.
That's what we actually did. When we saw, okay, the weight is going down, we stopped. And then after reaching again the weight of the normal age group, we treated again, and still the tumor was shrinking. Yeah.
Thank you.